Yuval Harari, thank you so much for your time. It's a pleasure to meet you. You talk about three revolutions that brought us here. Can you briefly tell us about those revolutions?
Yeah, the first was a cognitive revolution about 70,000 years ago, which transformed one human species, Homo sapiens, from an insignificant animal into the most powerful force on this planet, and brought us here to the position when we completely dominate the ecological system. Then we had the agricultural revolution 10,000 years ago, which again gave humans even more power, enabling them to start building villages and cities and kingdoms and empires and dominate the other animals and plants. And finally, the scientific revolution, which began about 500 years ago, and we are still just seeing maybe the beginning of it, and which gives us really divine powers of creation and destruction. We can now not just control the other animals and the plants and the forests, we can actually start to redesign and re-engineer and manufacture animals and plants and even humans in the future, and change the very course of the evolution of life.
And you explained the gossip theory and the power of myths, what glued us together as a species.
Yeah, when we speak about the cognitive revolution 70,000 years ago, so I said that before this revolution, humans were insignificant animals. We did not have a big impact on the planet. We were just basically like, like you have the chimpanzees and the gorillas, so you also had humans. And there are many different species of humans. Today, you have just one species of human everywhere. You go to Australia or Canada, to Iran or to Israel, it's the same humans. But 70,000 years ago, you had different human species in different areas of the world. Homo sapiens, our species, lived only in Africa. The Middle East, for example, was home to the Neanderthals, a different human species. What gave Homo sapiens immense power and enabled us to spread all over the world and basically annihilate all the other humans and change the world is our unique ability to cooperate in very large numbers. We are the only animal that can cooperate in really an unlimited number of individuals can cooperate on a single project to build a city, to build a spaceship, whatever. And we do it with two basic abilities. It's all based on our language, really. The first linguistic ability is really to gossip. People often don't appreciate how important gossip is, but the first big human societies were built on the foundation of gossip. Chimpanzees cannot gossip. So the numbers of chimpanzees that can cooperate remains very, very limited, because to cooperate with somebody, you need to know whether you can trust them. Now, a chimpanzee, to know if I'm a chimpanzee and you're a chimpanzee and I want to know if you're trustworthy, I can only know what I see. But if you're doing things behind my back, I can't know that. Humans can gossip, and this is what most humans, even today, most of what they talk about is gossip. Even if you go to a scientific conference and you meet the most brilliant physicists or historians in the world, most of what they talk about is not physics or history, it's gossip about somebody from the department who did this or did that. And this is because it's the foundation of society. But still, gossip is limited. If you gossip, you can still get to know just about a couple of hundred people, not more than that. To get to a level when millions of people can cooperate to build a city, a nation, an empire, you need something beyond. And that something beyond is fiction, stories. Really, we control the world because we are the only animal that can create fictional stories, spread them around, and convince millions of people to believe in the same story. That's the case in many religions, but that's also the case even in the economy. Money, and without money, you would not have any modern economy, any trade network. Money is just a story. It's not an objective reality. You have these colorful pieces of paper, they have no objective value. You can't eat them, you can't drink them. But if you convince millions of people in a story told by the big bankers and finance ministers that this piece of paper is valuable, like this piece of paper is worth a banana, then if everybody believed that, I can take this worthless piece of paper, go to a supermarket, to the market, meet somebody I never met before, I never even gossiped about this person before, and still, because we both believe in the same fictional story about this piece of paper, we can trade. Chimpanzees can't do it. Chimpanzees sometimes trade. I give you a banana, you give me a coconut, that can work. But you give a chimpanzee a piece of paper, and you expect him to give you a banana in exchange, it won't happen. They don't believe these stories.
And then you use the analogy of banana about religion.
Yes.
Why is it still so attractive to billions of people?
You mean religion?
Religion.
Yes. Yeah, because it gives simple answers to very complicated stories. To very complicated questions. Like, how did the world begin? Or what will happen to us after we die? And so forth. I think there is a huge tension and sometimes contradiction between religion and spirituality. Spirituality is about questions, is about asking deep questions about the world. Who am I? What is the meaning of life? What happens after we die? What is the good life? What is good? And spirituality means that you ask this question, it's very important in your life, and you go on a quest to find an answer. Religion is not about the question. It's about an answer that you must accept. Somebody comes and tells you a story. This is what happens after you die. This is how everything began. This is the good. And you must accept this story and not ask any questions about it. So very often religion and spirituality are just the opposite. And unfortunately, for many, many people, they prefer to be given simple answers that don't allow you to question them, instead of really going on this difficult and sometimes painful quest to find answers to the big questions of life.
Now let's come to present. You mentioned how humans are interested in stories, and you mentioned that until a couple of decades ago, there were three stories. We had fascism, communism, and liberalism, and the first two died. And since 2016, you seem worried about liberalism.
Yes.
What is the biggest threat against liberal democracy?
Speaking from the deep perspective, of course, on the surface, we now see the rise of various populist regimes all over the world, which undermine the foundations of liberal democracy. But really, the deepest threat is coming from the laboratories, from the new scientific discoveries and the new technologies. The rise of artificial intelligence and biotechnology means that very soon it will be possible to hack human beings. To hack human beings means that somebody outside me, a corporation or a government, can understand me better than I understand myself, can understand my desires, my feelings, my emotions, and then they can not only predict my choices, they can also manipulate my desires and increasingly take decisions on my behalf. Now, to hack a human being, to really understand what's happening in my mind, you need three things. You need a lot of biological knowledge, you need a lot of computing power, and you need a lot of data. When you have all these three, you can hack human beings and completely control them. Now, in the past, nobody had these three ingredients. Even if you think about something like the Soviet Union in the time of Stalin, so the KGB could follow people around all day, but the KGB did not have enough biological knowledge or computing power or data to actually decipher what's happening inside you. So they could know where you go and who you meet, but they couldn't really tell how you feel. Now we see the emergence of technologies that can enable corporations and governments to access your mind, to go under not only where you go and who you meet, what you actually feel, what you actually think, each and every moment. And once you have this technology, you can create total surveillance regimes that follow everybody all the time and know not just what they do, but also what they feel. And this can give rise to totalitarian regimes worse than anything we have seen in the 20th century.
But before we get there, we can see the rise of Donald Trump, we can see Brexit, we can see the emergence of right-wing movements throughout Europe.
Yes.
What is causing that, you reckon?
I'm not sure. I don't think that anybody knows for sure. To some extent, it could be also an accident.
But do you think that the liberalism has failed?
It, on one level, it hasn't failed. It is still the best political system that humans have ever managed to create. It has its problems. Nothing is perfect, but it's better than all the alternatives. And humans in the early 21st century, under the liberal system, are more healthy and prosperous and peaceful than ever before. Part of the problem that we see in Europe and other places around the world is that simply people fail to appreciate and to be thankful for the achievements of the past. With all the problems that we have, today fewer people die from starvation than from obesity. Fewer people die from disease, from plagues, than from old age. And violence kills fewer people than accidents. This is the first time in history that we are in this situation. Actually, you are far more likely to die from eating too much than from human violence. That's an amazing achievement, which is largely the achievement of liberalism. But people now take it for granted. Like when they voted about Brexit, they took the peace in Europe for granted. They don't realize that if the European Union breaks up and each country becomes more nationalist and cares more and more only about itself, there is no guarantee that war will not return to Europe. For centuries, Europe has been torn by terrible wars and conflicts. And only in the last few decades, largely thanks to the European Union, we have seen the establishment of peace in Europe. If the EU breaks up, we could see the return of war. But people don't think about it because they take for granted the achievements of the last decades. But I think that beyond that, one of the problems of liberalism, which causes this wave of populism and extremism, is that people are correctly sensing that they are being left behind, that the new technologies, artificial intelligence, biotechnology, and all that, they are creating a new world, but this new world is shaped by a very, very small elite, largely to the benefit of this small elite, and that more and more people are simply being left behind, and they are losing the power even to understand what's happening in the world. In the 20th century, the big fight was against exploitation. People were afraid to be exploited by the economic and political elite. And this was the background for the rise of socialism and social democracy, to make sure that people are not exploited in an unjust way. In the 21st century, I think the big struggle will not be against exploitation, it will be against irrelevance. More and more people and more countries might lose completely their economic relevance and also their political power. It can happen within societies, but it can also happen between countries. In the 19th century, the Industrial Revolution was led by a few countries like Britain and Germany and the United States. Most countries were left far behind, like China and India and most of the Middle East, and they were therefore conquered and exploited. This can happen again with the rise of AI and biotechnology. And the countries left behind this time might completely lose all their economic relevance and political power. And we will see greater inequality than ever before. And so far, the liberal order doesn't offer a solution for this problem. And people are sensing all over the world that they are losing their power and relevance and something must be done. So they follow these populist leaders because they offer a quick fix. Populism is really about somebody coming along, placing all the blame on some group in society, immigrants or a religious minority or gays and lesbians or somebody, and promises that if you give me all the power, I will make things okay. But once in power, the populists just focus on dismantling all the checks and balances on their power. They captured, say, the government, and now their main aim is not really to solve the problems of society. They don't know how to solve the problem of society. They focus on attacking and destroying any alternative balancing power. So they attack the courts and the free press and the universities, and to concentrate all the power in their hands. And this is what we see on the surface happening now in more and more countries.
You mentioned in 21 Lessons for the 21st Century that major countries have not succeeded in a major war in this century.
Yes.
And you rightly said that Israel has so far avoided a war. Mm-hmm. With the current climate, you also mentioned human stupidity. In the current climate, do you think that politicians in both our countries, Iran and Israel, will avoid another war?
I hope so, but I don't know. I mean, there are growing tensions in the Middle East. And very often the problem is that even politicians who don't want war, they are caught up in an escalating arms race and deteriorating situation. And, you know, it starts with the rhetorics. They don't want to seem weak, but then they become captives of their own rhetoric, of their own tricks. And we saw this before in history, that countries that did not really want to go to war and didn't have anything to gain from the war, nevertheless were unable to prevent that. And speaking about human stupidity, you know, when you look, for example, at the Second World War, before the war, the people who instigated the war, the leaders in Germany, in Italy, in Japan, they told their population that we have no choice but to go to war. Unless we go to war, we will not be able to have a prosperous society because we will be exploited by others. Now, the amazing thing about the Second World War is that after they lost the war, they actually became more prosperous than ever before. Germany and Japan and Italy, they lost the war, and they became more prosperous in the 1950s and 60s than ever before. It was a complete lie, a complete misunderstanding to think that we must have a war and we must win the war in order to improve the situation of our people. And I think it's also true today that there is very little to be gained even from winning a war, say in Iran or in Israel. But people are falling victim to this idea that we have no choice. Unless we go to war and win it, then we will be exploited and we will be blocked by other powers which will not allow us to develop and to prosper. And this is not true, but unfortunately too many people believe that it is true.
Sometimes it looks like politicians in many countries tend to exaggerate threats. Mm-hmm. In West, we can see that they exaggerate the threat of terrorism. In
yes.
Iran and Israel, they exaggerate the threat of the other country. What do they gain from this?
In a situation when you feel threatened, there is less room to criticize the government because then you are immediately labeled a traitor. Like, this is war now. We're in a national emergency. We all have to unite around the government. And anybody who opposes that or criticizes the government is a traitor. This is like, we saw it throughout history. So it's the same logic with, you know, with terrorism in the West, as you say. And this is why very often, even in a situation when there is no real threat, leaders are manufacturing artificial threats because it strengthens their position at home. It also relieves them of the burden of the problem of finding real solutions to the real problems of society. If society is suffering, say, from a lot of corruption, if the healthcare system is not functioning well, it's very difficult to solve that. But then you tell the people, forget about healthcare, forget about corruption, there is war, the enemy is at the gate. Then immediately people forget about these other issues, and everybody, because, you know, it really goes back to our evolution. The easiest way to grab people's attention is to make them frightened. This is how we are built, really, as animals. So if you want to distract the public from issues like government corruption, or like deteriorating healthcare system, or deteriorating education system, the best thing is to find an external enemy that threatens the survival of the nation, and immediately that gets all the attention, and people forget about the other things.
Looking further in future, you mentioned three major threats against human species: nuclear war, global warming, and technological disruption. Mm-hmm. Starting with nuclear war, do you think that we are, as humans, are we stupid enough to press the button, and have we forgotten about the disastrous consequences of a nuclear war?
In a way, nuclear war is kind of, you know, the easiest problem to think about, because at least everybody realizes the danger. You know, with climate change, some people deny it. With nuclear war, nobody says, no, there is no such thing, or nothing bad will happen. No, everybody knows it's an existential threat to humanity. And everybody is keen to avoid pressing the button. In a situation of crisis, especially the weaker side might be tempted to press the button before if it faces, say, losing a war, or a regime that faces collapse might be tempted to go to the extreme of using nuclear weapons, or religious fanatics that believe that, okay, everybody dies, but after we die, we go to heaven, so what do we care? We'll be millions and millions of years in heaven, so what do we care of pressing the button? So there are extreme situations in which we might see nuclear war, even though everybody knows it's really the end of humankind.
Global warming, when we look at politicians like Donald Trump getting out of Paris Treaty and other politicians who don't believe in global warming, what can we do about that?
Elect different politicians?
If it was possible.
Yeah, if it was possible. In some places, and increase public pressure through education, through media coverage, to make people realize this is a real threat, it's not a hoax, and it's not in the far future, it's already happening in the present, and the impact on the lives of people could be disastrous in many different ways. You know, people who live around the coast and the sea is rising, changes in temperature and climate impact agriculture, the spread of disease, natural disasters. This has a real impact on the life of millions of people around the planet. So, you know, terrorism kills a handful of people, and you have all the governments and millions of people terrified from it. Climate change can kill not a handful of people, but millions upon millions of people. And we should place climate change far above terrorism in our list of problems. Unfortunately, in terms of, again, grabbing human attention, terrorism is much more effective. It's theatrical. Terrorism is like 95% theater. It's about staging a show of violence to grab people's attention. And unfortunately, the media usually cooperates with that because, you know, it's much easier to sell a newspaper with a headline like "Terrorism Plot" than with a headline like "Global research indicates that global warming is blah, blah, blah," and people already lose attention.
We're trying our best.
Yeah, but it's really difficult because, yeah, it goes back to human nature. I mean, we evolved from apes in the African savanna. As apes in the African savanna, we weren't adapted to thinking about climate change because apes usually don't change the climate. But violence from a neighboring group, this was a daily threat. So we are really built to be very focused if some stranger who doesn't look like us comes along and threatens us, immediately all the attention goes there. But we are not built to notice climate change or to take responsibility for that, because nothing in our evolution prepared us for this situation that we have today, that we are actually changing the climate and endangering the entire ecological system.
Reading Homo Deus, I wish I had read it before I had children. I might have changed my mind about having them. It's quite worrying, the way you predict the future. How can we equip the next generation who will be alive in 2050 to be prepared for that?
Well, we have to be honest that we don't know what kind of world we will be in 2050. It's the first time in history that we have no idea about even the basic facts of society 30 or 40 years from now. In the past, you could never predict the political situation, like who will be king, but you always knew the basic facts about, say, the economy, the job market, the type of skills humans would need. If you lived, say, 1,000 years ago in Persia, then you knew that, okay, whoever is king in 30 years, most people will still be farmers and herders, so I had better teach my kid how to plant wheat and how to make bread and how to herd the cattle and how to ride a horse. But today, we have no idea what the job market would look like in 2050, except that it will be very different from today, and it will be very volatile. Because of the impact, growing impact of AI and biotech, the job market will keep changing more and more rapidly. So the one thing we are sure that young people will need is the ability to keep learning and reinventing themselves throughout their lives, to keep changing their profession, their job. So I would say that we need to focus in education today, not on particular skills, but actually on mental flexibility, teaching kids to have a very flexible mind so that they will be able to keep learning and reinventing themselves throughout their lives. So it's not teaching a particular skill like mathematics or Chinese or coding computer. It's really building a different kind of personality. Again, even biologically, we are kind of programmed to do most of our learning in our young age. And as we grow up, yes, we continue to learn new things and acquire more skills, but generally, we mostly make use of the basic skills we gained in our early age. And in the 21st century, this will not be good enough. You will have to completely kind of reinvent yourself when you're 40, and again when you're 50, and again when you're 60, because the world will keep changing more and more rapidly.
Mm-hmm. And finally, you talk about irrelevance and the fact that we will have a useless class and probably billions of people who will become useless as the rise of AI and technology. What can we do about them?
It's not that there won't be any jobs. There will be a lot of new jobs. The two problems are that people will need to retrain themselves for the new jobs, and this demands a huge investment from the people and from the governments. Let's say you're a truck driver, and in 20 years you lose your job to a self-driving vehicle, but there is a new job in designing computer games or in teaching yoga. So you need time to reinvent yourself, to learn new skills. Somebody needs to support you during that time. Now, in a rich country, then the government can step in and support these difficult transitions. But in poor countries, there might not be the government support, the financial support to do that, we basically need to build an entirely new educational infrastructure to help people keep learning and changing throughout their lives. Some countries might be able to do it, other countries won't, and these countries face complete collapse. In the 20th century, the poor countries, their main resource, unless they had mineral wealth like oil or gas, their main resource was cheap labor. But automation means that cheap labor will lose its value. So to stay relevant, people will need to learn new skills, but poor countries will not be able to afford this educational transition. So I'm not so worried about a country like Switzerland or Canada or the US. I guess they will be okay. They will benefit a lot from the AI revolution, and they will be able to re-educate their population in time. But many other countries throughout the world, in Africa, in the Middle East, in Latin America, they will not benefit from the AI revolution. They will lose what they have, and they will not be able to re-educate and re-skill, retrain their workforce fast enough. So they might completely collapse. Unless we have a kind of global safety net that redistributes the benefits, the wealth created by the new technology between all parts of the world, we might see a situation of extreme inequality when some countries become far, far richer than they are today, and other countries completely collapse and lose all their economic and political power.
Thank you very much, Yuval Noah Harari. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.